Good morning.
That was a nice, loud good morning for the crowd that we've got here. Well done. My name is Paul Bratch. I am the Director of Discipleship here. We want to welcome you this morning to Onalaska United Methodist Church. Thanks for braving the snow and the roads. I feel like every Sunday when I'm up here, I'm just talking about the snow that's happening outside. Eventually, that's got to stop. This morning, before we begin, we just have a few announcements to share with you. First of all, Pastor Park is leading a spiritual retreat, the Walk to Emmaus, this weekend. And so he isn't here with us this morning, and so we are fortunate to have Pastor Don Iliff with us this morning, and he'll be sharing the message in a little bit. If you haven't already, you should have one of these blue cards in your bulletin. And feel free to pull that out and fill that out and drop that in the offering baskets. If you are new, we would love to have your information just so we can connect with you and help you get connected to the things going on here at OUMC. You may have noticed that we still have the photo booth going on out in the entryway. The towners are out there, and they would be happy to take your picture, your family picture. We want to get some updated pictures for the church directory. And so if you're interested in that, you can just head on out into the entryway after the service and let them know. They should be here through, I believe, 12:30 or so today. So we have a wonderful Stephen ministry here. They do a whole lot when it comes to just walking alongside people who are going through tough times in their lives. And our Stephen ministers are looking to recruit more ministers right now. They are going to be starting up another training class beginning in April. And so if you're interested at all in talking with them about what it might be like to become a Stephen minister, you can talk with either Ellie Molstead or Becky Barnes, and they can get you information about that and an application. Applications are due by March 24th. And then we have a brand new small group that is going to begin this week. And it's called Love Does. It's being led by Jessica Gobel and Becky Barnes. Did you want to come up and say anything, or are we just showing the video? Okay, we've got a quick video to show you.
Do you ever feel just stuck? Like you had all these hopes and dreams about what your life would be like, and you want to weave together your faith and your life, and you're just at this place where you can't move. Well, I was thinking about some of those things, and I wrote a book called Love Does, and it was helpful to me in thinking through what the next steps are. Like, what do I do to live into the person that Jesus made me to be, and how can I learn more about Him along the way? And you know what the answer for me was? I did stuff. I know that sounds crazy, but I just started doing stuff. And the more stuff I did, the more I learned about Him. We put together some curriculums, some DVDs, and some written materials. We hope you'll take a look at them in your small groups and ask these questions of each other. Have these conversations happen about, like, what's the next step for you? How do we, like, go do love? Not just agree with Jesus or gather a bunch more information about, but, like, what's the next step? So I hope when you read these materials, when you look at the DVDs, when you're meeting in your small groups, you'll ask these questions about love, and then you can relate to each other times where you've seen how when you do stuff, what you've learned more about who God made you to be and more about who He is along the way. Because love isn't just a bunch of stuff we agree with. Love does.
All right, so that group is beginning this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. And if you are interested in joining that group, you can just go ahead and show up on Wednesday. You have probably seen in the media in some form or another a story about the diaper drive that's happening here. I believe they've been in the La Crosse Tribune on the front page. Megan Pence would add above the fold, too. She's pretty proud of that. And they've been on Channel 8, Channel 19, they've been on the radio, and we've had a huge response from our congregation and from the community also. This last week we were getting people dropping in every day who had just seen a story about it on TV, and so they'd bring 100 diapers or so and drop them off here at church. So that's going really well. We don't have a current count on the diapers for you this morning, unfortunately, but they are getting very close to their goal. And next weekend is the weekend that they will be going out and shopping for the diapers. So there is still time, if you want to bring in more diapers this week during office hours. And then finally, our all-church bowling party is happening on March 10th at 12:30 after the services. And if you're interested in coming to that, it's a free event. There's food provided, pizza and meatballs and all kinds of good stuff. It's a really fun event. You can RSVP on the green card that's in your bulletin, or there's a sign-up sheet outside the office also. If you weren't able to hear all of that, the Onalaska Holman Food Basket, which is an organization that our church really supports heavily, they lost an entire freezer of fresh meats. So if you're able at all to help out by donating meat or donating money that they could use to replace all of that, that would be greatly appreciated. Okay, well, let's begin our worship today by standing and greeting each other with the peace of Christ.
As we begin this time of worship, I invite you to join with me in our opening prayer, praying together and saying, "With all our heart, we take refuge in God Most High, who created all things, the merciful Father, source of all goodness. With all our heart, we take refuge in Christ, the Redeemer from sin, who restores our true nature, the perfect and mysterious Word. With all our heart, we take refuge in the One who embraces the universe, who at all times and in all places responds to our needs, the pure and tranquil Holy Spirit. Amen." Our opening hymn, "How Firm a Foundation," verses 1 through 3 and 5, found on page 29.
Saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in His excellent Word. What more can He say than to you He has said, to you who for refuge to Jesus have fled? Fear not, I am with thee, O be not dismayed, for I am thy God, and will give thee aid. I'll strengthen and help thee, and cause thee to stand, upheld by my righteous omnipotent. Thank you.
You may be seated. The scripture that is selected today for our consideration is Psalm 121, and I will refer to it at different times through the message. Hear now these words of the Lord. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. The children's time. Children may come forward.
Good morning. Good to see you guys. Made it out into the to the cold today and the snowy weather. No, I did not ride my bicycle today. And no, it did not break down. So we have been talking about family during our service the last few weeks. And I thought I'd bring a bicycle tire because what better to represent a family than a bicycle tire? You should see the looks I'm getting up here. Well, first I want you to look at this part. This is called the hub of a basketball tire, okay? Bicycle tire, thank you. And do you see where it's located? Where is that? What would you call that? The middle, the center of the wheel. And that's where it has to be super strong. And if we didn't have that hub there, how do you think the bicycle tire would move? Like this? All wobbly? Yeah. So that keeps it strong. And it's important for everything to run smoothly so that this is strong in the center. And that's why it's important for us to keep God at the center of our families so things run smoothly, okay? Now, I want to look at another part of the tire. What do you guys call these? Spokes. Yeah. So the spoke runs from the center hub here out towards the outside of the wheel. Now, if these, when it's connected here, you can see that's pretty strong, isn't it? Now, if these weren't connected or they're broken up or they're real flimsy, what would happen when you rode your bike? This again? Yeah, it would be really wobbly and not real stable. So I want to look back at those spokes again, okay? Those spokes are connected to our hub, which is God, okay? And what do you notice about the spokes down here compared to the spokes up here? Watch my fingers. Yeah. So as the spokes get closer to the hub, they're getting closer together as we move down here. And as they go away, so if we think of God that way, when we are really close to God, it helps our family be close together. But if we go move away from God, sometimes in our families, if we're not being nice to each other or we're not thinking of our family members very kindly, then it makes us kind of move away from God. And it means that we're not keeping God in our sights. So that's what I want you to think of when you see wheels or you're on your bicycle this spring, and is that when you look at how a bicycle wheel looks, when we stay closer to God, it helps us stay closer together as a family. And that can be a family in your home, it could be a family of your friends, a family in your classroom, a family at church, all those good places where you see families. Okay? Let's pray. Good and gracious God, thank you for each one of these kids here today. Help them to always keep you at the center of their families. We know when you are at the center of our families, we can live at peace with everyone. Help us to do our part to help our families stay close to God. Amen. Thanks for coming up.
Well, next I want to invite Craig Richason up to the front. And Craig is going to share with us the results of the soup supper and tell us more about the summer camps.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I got lucky today. Bad weather. I don't like doing public speaking, so empty church worked out just fine. Well, again, is when we had the soup supper, is we had bad weather. And then we ended up with the polar coming down through sub-zero weathers, and we ended up with a lot of extra soup, but the extra soup went to the warming center and also Salvation Army. So between the two, we donated about 18 gallons of soup. So hopefully we kept a lot of people full and warm during the sub-zero weather. I'd like to have Jessica come up. So that night we served about 129 people, and we did quite well. And I'd like to present a check to Jessica for $1,521 that we can donate for summer camp scholarships.
Yes, this is so generous of all of you. Thank you for organizing things, Craig, and getting your team together to make this a great event. And this, we already have about 8 kids signed up for camp, and this will pay for them all for their scholarships. So thank you very much.
Please join me in our prayer of confession. The Lord God is merciful and gracious, endlessly patient, loving, and true, showing mercy to thousands, forgiving iniquity, transgression, and sin, and granting pardon. Amen. And we continue with our response song, Make Us One.
Jesus, be my guide and hold me to
to my path.
There have been many times that I have observed the God moment of different ones in the congregation sharing a moment in which God has touched their life. And I had a most profound experience that I thought I would like to share. And so I talked to Pastor Park last fall, and I said, I know you've got things scheduled, but you know, if you ever need a God moment, just let me know. And he said, well, things are pretty well set through the fall, but we'll talk. So he called or emailed and said, how about February? February's wide open. And so then he said, how about the 24th? And I said, well, that'd be fine. And I said, the problem I am experiencing with that is how to limit it to, you know, 5-10 minutes or so. And he said, well, we'll work that out. And then it turns out that he needed to be gone. And he said, how about you just expand, and that'll be fine. So what happened was, in September of 2017, Mary Pat Willis, a member of the Stoddard United Methodist Church, called me, and she said, Pastor Don, she said, I have two questions for you. I said, all right. Number one, she said, are you still doing stained glass? Yes, I've been doing stained glass as a hobbyist for probably 25 years. Oh, very good. Well, I'm wondering if you could do a stained glass piece for our church. Well, you know, I suppose, I don't know. I said, let's talk. So my wife Judy and I drove down to Stoddard one late morning, and we met with Mary Pat there at the Stoddard United Methodist Church. And I began to realize right away we were on two different wavelengths. I've made, you know, stained glass pieces like this that you hang in the window or something of that type. And so that's what I was imagining that she was going to ask me to do. And she said, you see that circular window up there? She said, don't you just think a stained glass window would look good up there? Well, yeah, I guess it would. That would look nice, yeah. Well, I'm wondering if you would do that. Oh, Mary Pat, I said, I do stuff like this. You're talking 4-foot diameter. You're talking of something that's 4 times larger than anything I've ever done before. And so we kind of talked, and she didn't take no for an answer, you see. And she began to kind of talk about her vision and kind of what she thought it should be and how it could be and all that kind of thing. And so I don't know if it was a moment of inspiration or a moment of weakness. I said, yeah, I guess I could do that. Well, of course, in churches we have to have committees, and so we had a couple of committee meetings, and I knew of a company out in the state of Maryland that drew patterns for stained glass hobbyists. And so I talked to them at some length, and they were willing to to draw something for us, and so there was a certain amount of back and forth. And so on the 23rd of December, I received two full-scale patterns and what they call a glass recipe, all of the colors, the glass to fit into that. And so after the first of the year, there was a church member down in Genoa that had been doing stained glass for many years, and so I went down there, and he wanted to donate a lot of glass, and so I received the glass. And then I went down to Visions of Light on 4th Street and spent a considerable amount of time there picking out glass and all that. So I got all of that glass together and all that stuff. Now, on this, that's the finished product. There's 1,050 pieces in that, and it required 46 different colors, and you know, about 6 different shades of green, and 4 or 5 different shades of brown, and so on and so on and so on, and different textures and types of glass. And so that was fine. Keeping track of all of that became the first problem that I had. Anytime you go from something like this to something like this, you don't realize it, but you multiply some of the challenges that you will face. And so anyway, I got going on all of that the second week of January of 2018. And I was pretty excited about this project, and I began to work at it. Now, with glass, stained glass, it sounds funny, but it's true. Some glass is brittle and some glass is soft. And the softer glasses, like the greens, cut real easily. And you can cut a corner, you can cut corners and shape it quite nicely. The reds are more brittle, and so they are harder to cut. And so when you cut some of these angles like that, you have to cut a line this way and a line this way. And then there's a grinder that you grind down so that you get the angle like that. Now the dust that comes off of the grinder causes irreparable lung damage. And so what you have to do is the grinder has a reservoir of water. And so it makes it safe then. And the water then neutralizes the dust, and that's fine. But the downside to that is that the water also dissolves the line of your pattern. So you've drawn a line on this glass, and you're trying to grind it down to that line, but the water is dissolving it. And so that becomes one of the challenges. And then because there's 1,050 pieces, you've got to keep track of everything. And so with a magic marker, you number each piece, but the water dissolves that. So now you've got those two things working against you. And typically what I would do is I would cut out maybe 8 or 10 pieces, and then I would go and grind them and then fit them. The problem with glass, with stained glass, is you can't mush the pieces together. Either they fit or they don't fit. And so I would go back and forth between the grinder and the pattern probably 10 to 15 times for each piece, just so that you get it to fit. And then the problem becomes the next piece that comes along, you're putting that against that, and so then you take this piece out to re-grind that, and then you start putting them together, and if you're not careful, these over here will buckle. And so it's hard to tell the right side up or right side down on glass because of the way it is, unless it's got a real definite texture to it. And so because the numbers have all washed off, you're not sure exactly where it all is. And before you know it, you're spending more time rearranging the pieces and trying to figure out which one is which. And sometimes the curves and the angles are just enough, so it could be this way, it could be that way. And then when you bring this piece in, it doesn't fit. And you're standing during all this time and you're bending over the project, and before long you start to just physically and mentally wear out. And it becomes a real challenge to do all of this. And all of a sudden I realized that I was in over my head. I was doing something that was beyond my abilities, beyond anything that I'd ever done before. And I began to realize that the best I would do is make a mess of this whole thing. And I could not put that in their church. I could not give that to them. And what I needed to do is just find a way to gracefully get out of the project and to walk away. But I couldn't. There wasn't a plan B. There wasn't somebody that I could turn to. And the more I thought about it, the more I just became very anxious and troubled and frustrated and upset with myself for getting myself into this situation and how I was ever going to resolve this problem. And I just had, you know how it is when you get to a situation and
there is just no resolve. There is just no plan B. There is just nothing to go on. And I was just completely defeated and demoralized and disgusted with myself. And I just sat down. I sat down in a chair in my stained glass workshop, and I had no idea what was going to happen next. And one of the most profound things that has ever happened in my life happened at that moment. As I was sitting there, this voice in my head said, "Don, you are a Freemason, aren't you? And don't you, as Freemasons, have this saying, before any great or important undertaking, first invoke the blessing of deity. Before any great or important undertaking, first invoke the blessing of deity." I must admit, I was very startled. Masonry had not been anything I'd been thinking about at that time or leading up to that time. And so this just kind of, as we say, came out of the blue. I believed immediately that was the voice of God. There was absolutely no question in my mind. So I did what any one of you would have done at that point. I folded my hands and I bowed my head and I closed my eyes, because that's what we're taught in Sunday school, you know. And the prayer went something like this: "Lord, here's the deal. You know this project is going nowhere. I need you to manage the project. I'll be the hands, I'll do the work, but you need to manage this project. It's no longer my window, it's your window." So every day for the next 4 months, whenever I worked on the project, I sat down in that chair and I prayed that same prayer. I got up and I discarded the pieces that just were not working, and I began to work at putting together this window. The most interesting thing happened, and I didn't realize it at the time. I only realized it in retrospect, that as I worked on this window, my thought process was completely different. And that to me was kind of the profound moment for me as it transpired. I started out with the tree. The tree has 250 leaves and branches. I knew that was going to be the most difficult and the most time-consuming. It took over 2 weeks to do that. And as I was doing it, I didn't realize it at the time, but as I was doing it, I got to thinking about how God was going to be ministering to people as they viewed that window. Each piece is part of Scripture. So the tree is the tree that we know of as being in the Garden of Eden, the tree of good and evil. Every day we have choices that we make. Every day we can choose this way or that way. Each day we can choose words that are either healing or hurtful. Every day we have those kinds of things that are presented for us. And so maybe that tree would remind people of that. But praise the Lord, there's God's forgiving grace. And so maybe as they are struggling with the decisions and the things that make up their life, what it is, maybe they will understand that God is there ministering to them through that forgiving grace, and perhaps maybe things will turn around for them in their life. And so that's what was going on in my mind. It was still just as tedious, still just as time-consuming. Sometimes I kept track one day, and in 4 hours, I only got 40 pieces, 40 little leaves in place. But that was okay, because my mindset was, that's 40 I don't have to do tomorrow. And praise the Lord, I got those 40 in place, and we can move on from there. From there, I went to the lion and the lamb. Now, in Scripture, it says the wolf will lie down with the lamb, but we've contemporized it, and it's more the lion and the lamb, a symbol of peace. And I got to thinking about how so many times in our lives there is turmoil and difficulty and struggle. How many times in our lives we deal with relationships that really aren't very peaceful. And so we need to be thinking about how we're going to allow God's presence into our lives to help us to soften our responses to people, and how we can be the one that actually brings together peace among people within our families and within our places of work. And so that was going through my mind as I was putting together the lion and the lamb. The water, the stream, is Psalm 1. Be like a tree planted by the streams of water. Water is so valuable, so important, so necessary in our lives that we would die without water. And so water becomes a very important symbol and reality in our lives. We also use water in baptism, and we talk about washing away our sins and how God comes into our lives and helps to renew and strengthen us through the experience of baptism, and we're brought into the family of God in a symbolic way, and how that is a blessing to us. There was a time when Jesus was there by a well, and this woman came to the well to draw water at a time that wasn't the normal time, and he realized that she obviously must have been an outcast, someone that didn't fit in with the other women of that village. And he began to talk with her, and she was talking about water, and he was talking about the water of eternal life and the kinds of relationship that develops as you give yourself over to the care and keeping of God, and as God is working in and through you, how that presence changes you, and that living water, what an important part of it that is. And I began to wonder, I wonder if people are going to be thinking about that as they view the window. And so I continued to the tedium of doing this and putting this all together. And then I went from there on to the mountains. For the Hebrew people, the hills, the mountains were symbols of God. They believed that God was symbolized there in that hillside, that the hills were majestic, they were roundabout, they were always there, they were steadfast, just as God is that way in our lives. So I began to wonder, you know, I wonder if that's what people will be drawn to that. Psalm 121, I lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. So I wonder if they're going to be drawn to that psalm and realize that presence of God working in their lives. You remember Moses went up on the mountain to receive the Ten Commandments, and Jesus and Elijah and Moses were up there for the Mount of Transfiguration, and Jesus went up on the mountain to pray. I wondered if people would be thinking about those kinds of things. And then from there, in the center, it's hard to see it, but in the center, there is the cross of Christ with the white linen and that covenant that we have with God through our Savior Jesus Christ, and the message of his presence and the faith that grows from that relationship. And up in the left-hand corner, there's a dove with an olive branch, the covenant that God made with Noah. And so this window came together after over 200 hours and 3 to 4 months worth of work. And I really believed that it was a blessing from God, that it was that God was working in and through me. And I didn't realize how my whole mindset was changed as I realized that God was managing the project. God took away all of the frustrations, all the tediousness. God took away all of the anxious moments and the I can't do this and I'm not qualified to do this. God took all of that away and managed the project and gave me simply the task of doing one piece at a time. Another interesting experience happened. At the end of, after you get it all done, you put a piece of zinc came, C-A-M-E. It's a U-shaped channel that goes around the glass. It finishes it off, and it also gives it some added strength. I had done the measurements, and so I knew that I needed a half-inch zinc came. And in my box of all of this, I inadvertently grabbed the 3/8. And so I had bent it and attached it all the way around, and then when I reached in the box to pull out the second piece, and it took 2 6-foot pieces, I realized I had done the wrong one. You can go back and you can remelt the solder and you can take it off, but you spoil a lot of things and break some glass. And so something just said to me, done is done, and add the other 3/8-inch one, and then deal with it at the installation. When I got to that point, I called Alan Stage of Stage Glass Restoration in Holman. He had done all the windows at Wesley when we refurbished those, and I told him the story and asked him if he would help me with the installation. I figured a 70-year-old man climbing a 10-foot ladder with a 70-pound piece of glass probably wasn't a smart idea. And so he and his son came down, and they installed the window. And when they put the window in place, he just turned around and he looked at me and he smiled and he said, "It fits like a glove." There was less than a 1/16 of an inch clearance all the way around. And in stained glass work, that's a perfect fit because you want just that little bit of extra space. What I thought was a problem ended up being the right piece of zinc came. What I thought was going to make things all wrong, God was managing the project, and God knew that my measurements were suspect, but knew what the right one was. And so, as I began to reflect upon all of that, it certainly had a profound and changing effect upon my life. And I began to realize that there are so many times in our lives when we realize we are in over our heads. We are involved in a situation that we are not prepared for. We don't have words to explain how we're going to get through this time. We're dealing with relationships that we don't quite understand how we're going to resolve it. And in a sense, you know, we drive off in all four directions. My experience has reminded me again and again, in those moments, that's when you sit down in the chair. You quiet yourself and you simply say, "Lord, here's the deal. I don't know where to go. I don't know what words to use. I don't know how to solve the situation that's before me. I need your guidance. I need you to manage this project, this situation, this relationship, this whatever I'm going through. I'll use my hands and my feet and my voice and my intellect and all of the talents and the abilities that I have. I will use all of that to the fullest. But you need to manage and guide and lead me through this experience." And you know what? My experience has been, God will. God will. "For I lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. He will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Let's pray.
Oh God, there are times that truly move us and challenge us and shape us. We ask that you would continue to be that source, that presence that manages us through all of the valleys and shadows of life. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Don, very much for sharing with us this morning. That was a beautiful work of stained glass and a beautiful story behind it, too. As we enter into our prayer time today, we have a chance to share our joys and concerns with God and with one another. What specific requests do we have this morning? Yes, so a prayer of thanks for the VIM group that went out to New Lisbon last weekend to help some of the people who were affected by the floods there, and continued prayers as they're still recovering. All right, so prayers for Jennifer Stevens, who is beginning chemo on Tuesday.
Your prayers.
Yes, thank you. So first of all, a thanks to Kimberly and to our musicians and people for kind of adapting this morning, as we had four choir members show up this morning, and so we had to kind of replan things on the fly. And then also Doug mentions that Keith Wong is having some pretty significant health issues right now, was diagnosed with rectal cancer and a tumor, and they were hoping to do surgery on that. The latest that we've heard is that they're not able to do the surgery on that yet because of some heart issues, and they're discovering that the heart issues are more serious than they thought, and they're trying to find out right now if they can do surgery for some heart valves in order to be able to then do the cancer surgery. So yes, definitely prayers for Keith and Kelly as they're going through that. Yes, so a thanks for Nancy's 80th birthday last weekend. Okay, your old teacher's husband just had surgery and is recovering from that. And thank you for sharing that. Ah, okay, so it's Wesley's birthday today. He is turning 12. Yes, thank you for mentioning that. Prayers for those who are kind of on the front lines, putting themselves out there to protect us, and those plowing the streets also, absolutely. They've been working like crazy. So prayers for the special general conference that's happening for the United Methodist Church this weekend. I believe it goes through Tuesday, is that right? So prayers for wisdom for the people that are there trying to make a decision. And just prayers for unity in general in the midst of that. Okay, well, let's go ahead and lift up the prayers of the church, and we'll begin with just a moment of silence. Father God, creator of heaven and earth, have mercy and hear our prayers. God, this morning we bring before you many different kinds of prayers. Prayers of thanks for joyful things like birthdays for Nancy and Wes. Prayers of thanks for people stepping up and sharing their gifts this morning, like Kimberly and Sandy and those who have been assisting this morning with the service. We also thank you for the VIM group that was able to go out to New Lisbon and to do some work on homes of people who have been affected by flooding there. We pray that you would be with them as they continue to recover. And then we also, we pray for those who are dealing with health issues. We pray for Jennifer, as she begins chemo on Tuesday, that it would go well, that she would be healed of the cancer, that she would experience your peace and your comfort as she's going through the chemo. We pray also for Keith and Kelly Wong as he's dealing with some significant health issues. God, we pray that they would be able to fix what's wrong and be able to do the surgeries, and that Keith would ultimately be healed. And then we pray also for the husband of Logan's former teacher who is recovering from surgery, and we ask that you would help him to recover quickly. And then finally, We want to ask for your blessing upon the special general conference that's happening for the United Methodist Church right now. God, we pray that that as a group they would be able to come up with the most helpful solution and the thing that is going to bless the most people. God, we ask that in the midst of that we would experience peace and unity as a church. And God, we just ask for your continued blessing moving forward as a church. God, for all of these requests this morning, we just ask that your kingdom would come on earth as it is in heaven, that our church, our community, our world would be a little bit more like heaven. We ask that you would come and you would bring good out of difficult situations, that you would bring peace and healing and hope and joy. And we ask now that you would bless us and empower us and send us out to share your love with everyone that we meet. Well, as God gives to us, we want to give what we have to others also, and so I'd invite the ushers to come forward for a collection. Please rise. Generous God, you are worthy to receive all glory, honor, and praise, for by your will all things are created and have their being. Bless now these gifts that we offer in thanks for your great faithfulness. Amen. I see that Paul Brown is here. Did you want to come up and share a quick announcement with us?
Thank you, Paul. Mm-hmm. For those that don't know, for the past several years, I have been the acolyte trainer. So the acolytes have an idea of what they're supposed to be doing when they're setting the table for worship. So, and so while I've been doing that, Diane Panzer has been doing all of the scheduling of the acolytes. She has recently resigned from that role, and so I've taken over that role. And unfortunately, I've discovered that we don't have very many acolytes to choose from anymore to perform or to provide the acolyte ministry. So I made an announcement I guess it was 2 weeks ago in second service. We wanted to make the same announcement during this service that if there's anybody that has kids or grandkids that would be interested in being involved with the acolyte ministry, to please refer them to me, and I'll be in contact with them to go ahead and set up a training. And then I am going to be doing a training after church, so after second service this coming Sunday, so 1 week from today, for anybody that is interested. And all of you are stalwarts, stoic for getting out here today, so. But it's a small group, and so I think I'll have Deb Cowan send a general announcement as well, just so that we catch as many people as possible. So that's it.
All right. Thank you, Paul. Well, we want to thank you for worshiping with us today, and we hope that your time this morning has impacted you. If you would like to meet with someone this week, just to chat or pray, feel free to call the office, Pastor Park, myself, any of our Stephen ministers, we would love to chat with you. Now may the Lord bless and keep you. May his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.